Moving a database to Oracle Exadata comes with the promise of transparent performance acceleration, regardless of workload. But what are these performance accelerators? How do they work? And how do you know if they're operating in your database? In this session, you'll get expert insights into Exadata's key performance features. You'll also see how the automatic workload repository reports can easily verify that you're getting the best out of your database on an Exadata. I'm Kothanda Umamageswaran, and I run the development of Exadata. When we started building an Exadata, we kept three guiding principles in mind. First, we chose the ideal database hardware. We scaled out the database optimized compute, networking, and storage, with scale out being the key. With the scale out architecture, as you add more storage and more compute, it automatically comes in with more CPU power and more networking, allowing for a perfect linear scaling of the entire system. We built these using standard servers. Second comes the secret sauce, the database aware system software. This has unique algorithms to vastly improve OLTP, analytics, and consolidation, and we'll go through that in more detail today. And third, we want to fully automate the management. The features that we enable must be simple to use and work out of the box. These are our guiding North Star principles. The same technology is available on premises, cloud a customer, or in the Oracle Cloud, providing you a full choice of deployment model. When we look at the customer adoption of Oracle Exadata, you can go across any geography and look at any vertical, and you will find an Exadata customer. We run the most mission-critical systems, financial trading, manufacturing, and a lot of e-commerce systems. We power petabyte warehouses that run incredibly fast due to our technology. We have captured most of the Fortune 100 with Exadata and a growing number of customers on the Exadata Cloud. Now, this is a technical talk, so we're going to shift gears now and start looking into how we achieve this transparent performance speedup. But before we do that, we first have to understand storage networking a bit better. So let's jump into some background. A single flash card runs at approximately 12 gigabytes a second. You can put that inside a single storage server and connect it to a 100 gigabit network and attach it to a database server. The key thing to note is that a single flash card at 12 gigabytes a second or 96 gigabits a second can saturate a 100 gigabits a second network. Most of the SANs in the real world don't run at 100 gigabit. That's just a single flash card, but your databases don't fit on a single flash card. So what do traditional storage vendors do? They need the additional capacity, so they add a lot more flash devices on their storage. A single flash card was enough to saturate a 100 gigabit link. So what ends up happening is that the front end of the storage gets bottlenecked, even though they try to add multiple ports. They just can't make this work. The cloud storage vendors came after this. They got clever. They said that they want to scale out the storage, but they couldn't just put one flash card per server. That would be cost prohibitive. So they put in 4 or 8 or 16 per server. Let's use the case that they put 4 per server. Since we know that a single flash card can saturate an entire 100 gigabit link, they got a 4x reduction in throughput just getting out of storage. But when you come to the database server, you carry the same bottleneck as before. The bottleneck moved, but it never really got solved. You now have hundreds of flash cards sending their data to the single database server that's just going to be able to consume all of that bandwidth. Now, with that background, let's look at how a traditional scan works in a database. Say you want to find all the customers who ordered an item over $1,000. The database brings all those data blocks from storage into the database. Notice that as it's going through this process, it's not getting the full flash bandwidth because of the bottleneck we just discussed. Now it goes through the data and finds that it got lucky. The first row contains a match. But as it goes through the remaining rows, the remaining 80% of the rows are not used by the database. So we just got a lot of data through a very thin pipe and then dropped 80% of the data on the floor. That doesn't make any sense, does it? And this is why we thought we need a whole new architecture. When you run the same query on an Exadata, we do something unique and special. Instead of getting the data to where the query is executed, we send the query to where the data resides. This is unique. The same set of operations happen, but now on the storage. The storage looks at this data and matches the first row. This aspect of matching just the row and sending the matched data alone is called row filtering. Not only that, since the query is only finding all the customers, it doesn't need to send the entire row back. It just needs to send the customer's name back. This is called column projection. And all the data that needs to be discarded is not sent back to the database at all. The database just gets the result that it needs. The fantastic thing about this idea is that the queries exploit full flash throughput. There's no loss of throughput through the various layers in the network. This architectural difference is amazing. Now, here's a section of an AWR report. Look for this section under instance activity stats. Also, look at the sections that start under with the word cell. The two stats that are highlighted are important to understand. One represents the total amount of data that the database thinks it needs to scan, and the other is the amount of data returned. You can see in this example that the amount of data returned is more than 100 times lower. The AWR report that you saw allows you to characterize the whole system, but in many cases, you want to understand how a specific SQL performs. In such a case, you can just use a SQL monitor report. When you see a table access storage full, you know that it's a full table scan that's happening in the storage. You have two pieces of additional information highlighted, a filter and a binocular. Clicking on the filter brings up the specific predicates that were sent to the storage. In this case, it's finding a specific order key. Clicking on the binoculars brings up the statistics in SQL Monitor that shows both the number of bytes eligible for filtering and the amount of data returned. Notice that in this case, we scanned 173 gigabytes and returned only 49 megabytes. That is more than a 3000x reduction in the data returned. This is what results in stellar performance on an Exadata. Let's look at a technology called Storage Index. Much like the previous slide, we have a table on storage. The customer asks us to find all the salsas that were ordered between March 14th and 20th. And the table, while it's logically contiguous, it can be split physically into 1 megabyte regions in which the table exists. For simplicity's sake, I'm showing 2 rows per megabyte. In reality, there'll be far, far more. We scan the first 1 megabyte block, find the salsa sale, and remember that in a new in-memory data structure called storage index, that the order date minimum is March 19th and the maximum is March 21. We scan the second 1 megabyte block. We don't find the salsa, but we remember that the order date minimum is March 23 and the maximum is March 24. So far, so good. Nothing extraordinary has happened. Now, the customer wants to find all the chips sold between April 7th and 13th. The query is different. At this point, when we scan, we just look at the in-memory data in the storage index. And just by looking at the minimum and the maximum values in the 1 MB regions, we can tell that there are no chips that were sold in those physical 1 megabytes. So there are no I/O performed for this query, and the entire result is directly from storage index. Pretty amazing. The fastest I/O is the one that isn't performed. So why do I show a table that has both order date and ship date? Some of the folks could argue that the same benefit as storage index can be obtained by partitioning that table. If you partition by ship date, the queries on order date won't benefit, and vice versa. With storage index, you can just load your data and go and query on any column as you would like. Let's look at some of the advances in storage index. Storage index has only 8 columns, right? No, that's just old news. Thankfully, there are enough articles now on the internet that correct this myth. Bring on your white tables. Storage index is stored in memory, so it's lost at shutdown, right? Again, that's so old news. In the recent releases, storage index can be persisted at shutdown automatically. Storage index doesn't just support min-max values. It stores bloom filters and other clever data structures. For example, think of state codes. If a block contains a value from Arizona and another from Utah, it doesn't mean that everything in between exists. The database automatically recognizes that the number of distinct values in the column is low and asks the storage server to use a bloom filter instead of a minimum and a maximum value. Storage index automatically adapts to changing workloads. New entries are created, older entries are purged automatically. And lastly, it works on multiple data types. And here's how you can see the savings from storage index in an AWR report. Again, look for the section under instance activity stats. In this case, 588 gigabytes are scanned and 252 gigabytes are saved by storage index. So approximately half the IOs are avoided by storage index, a huge savings. Let's look at how in-memory analytics is used on Exadata. As Exadata flash throughput starts approaching the memory throughput, we decided to take the in-memory technology present in the database and apply it on the storage. The Exadata storage server automatically transforms the data on disk into in-memory database columnar formats in the Exadata flash cache. This transformation is automatic. Once this transformation is done, this enables the CPUs to use the fast vector processing instructions on the storage servers. This unique architecture is extremely beneficial. Once the storage server processes the data using these vector processing instructions, it returns the data using the same format such that the database can continue using the vector processing instructions too. This enables Exadata to uniquely optimize next generation flash as memory. Now, not only are scans offloaded, aggregations are offloaded too. Let's look at the AWR report and how this is represented. As you have learned so far, the instance activity stats is a terrific source of information. In this example, the storage server processed 664 gigabytes of data and saved us from returning 445 gigabytes of data. And all of this happened using the vector instructions, making it extremely fast. I showed you how you can view the statistics per instance, but in some cases, you want to look at your Exadata and see how things are looking across your storage servers. I'm going to show you how to do that for Smart IO statistics, but as you can see, there is a plethora of statistics and reports that are available. Look for the section under Exadata statistics. In this report, the first column is the name of the cell and it's been masked with stars. The column megabyte requested is the amount that the database requests, and you can see that we're constantly optimizing these using either storage index or flash cache, and the net result is that there's more than 97% of the IOs that have been reduced across all storage servers. That is the offload efficiency column. That's amazing. The number of SQL operators that have been offloaded to Exadata storage is constantly growing, and in Oracle Database 19c, more than 440 SQL operators are offloaded to the Exadata storage server. Let's switch gears and look at OLTP. All of us know that the persistent memory is extremely fast, and now let's see how an Exadata works with persistent memory. There's no IO software executed, no interrupts, no context switches. How does that happen? Since the data is tiered, the hottest data is in persistent memory. The database uses a remote DMA to read the I/O directly from persistent memory. This is why there is no I/O software executed, no interrupts, no context switches. What is amazing is that we can do over 2 million IOs to a storage server with 0% CPU used on the storage. Pretty amazing. When you look in the AWR report, look for the section under single block reads. You can see that most of the IOs are served using RDMA, and all of those IOs run at below 19 microseconds. Log writes, as you know, are extremely critical for OLTP performance. Faster log writes means that the transactions get committed faster. The problem with a slow log write is that it's a bit like a stalled car on a freeway. You can move the car to the site, but the backlog takes a very long time to clear. So any log writes that are slow can slow down the entire database. The IOs on an Exadata are unique. The database issues one-way RDMA writes to persistent memory on multiple storage servers. Since the RDMA is sent to multiple storage servers, the IO is resilient to failures, and the RDMA is sent to persistent memory is eventually flushed to flash or hard disk storage in the backend. This bypasses the network and the IO software, the interrupts and the context switches, and all the other associated overheads, and results in up to 8 times faster log writes. Let's look at how persistent memory log looks on the AWR report. Specifically, look for the section called redo write histogram. For the 21 million waits that happened in this database, the average wait time was only 16.79 microseconds. That's pretty impressive. For the folks who are not using an Exadata, you'll find that the databases that you have are usually showing numbers in multiple hundreds of microseconds. And the best case, so an Exadata running at 16.79 microseconds is incredibly fast. Here are some of the techniques and features of an Exadata when it uses the shared persistent memory across all the databases. The aggregate performance of persistent memory across all the storage servers can be dynamically used by any database server. The aggregate performance and capacity can also be used dynamically. Not only that, you can enable policies and place limits on the amount of persistent memory that each database can actually use. The persistent memory on the storage servers is accessible to the database servers alone. It uses database access controls to determine who has access to persistent memory region. There is no operating system or local database access. This ensures that the contents of the persistent memory are secure. The contents of persistent memory are automatically mirrored across storage servers. This makes it resilient to any failure, either of the server or the persistent memory itself. It's incredibly reliable. The architecture makes it extremely simple to use. The persistent memory on the storage is created, namespaces are formed, regions are taken care of, and the customer has to do absolutely nothing to use all of this persistent memory. And if a persistent memory DIMM fails, you just have to remove it and put a new one. There's nothing else to do. The software present in the storage server automatically recreates any data structures back from the failed persistent memory DIMM, and the system starts using the new persistent memory DIMM for its data acceleration and redo acceleration. And for OLTP, it's the only platform that provides less than 19 microseconds for single block reads and redo lock commits, a unique and tremendous achievement that's unparalleled. Exadata also serves millions of IO requests per second, and that's just mind-boggling. And in conclusion, Exadata is the best platform for analytics, OLTP, and consolidation. What we saw specifically with analytics was that Exadata doesn't send the data from the storage back into the compute, but it's sending the query from the compute into the storage. That's unique. That results in an incredible amount of data reduction in storage. It uses unique technologies such as storage index to completely eliminate IOs. It also ensures that it can use the in-memory columnar formats such that it can run the storage, the flash that's present in the storage, at the speed of memory. All of these technologies are visible in the AWR report itself. So now you get a perspective of how analytics are sped up incredibly fast with an Exadata. For OLTP, the simplest use cases that we talked about, single block reads are running at less than 19 microseconds. The redo lock commits are running at less than 19 microseconds. Just absolutely fantastic. No IO context switches, nothing, just runs so fast. All the customers are consolidating their databases on an Exadata to get all of these benefits together. This is just absolutely fantastic. We're doing great on all these features, and all of them are visible using the AWR report. That's the key. The observability is extremely important, and you can see that all of the performance improvements that you have, all of the reductions in IO that you have, are all visible in an AWR performance report. These unique technologies are what make Exadata stand out. Exadata is the mission-critical database platform, and it's also now available on Clouded Customer. It was used available in on-premises before. It's also available in Clouded Customer. It's available in public cloud, and it's also available in a dedicated region of your own. And for more information on Exadata, visit oracle.com/Exadata and try out the autonomous database service that's powered by an Exadata free for an unlimited time. You'll love the performance benefits that you see. Thank you.